So welcome to the first video for hyperpigmentation series. So there are about three main hyperpigmentations, and so understanding what your skin type is very important in how your skin will respond not only to the sun and how your skin responds to hyperpigmentation, but not only that, is how to treat it. So that is what we're going to be talking about today. So the reason why it is important is just because a treatment worked for your family member, your coworker, or your friend, it doesn't mean it may necessarily be the right one for you. One, it may not be as effective, or two, it may be very inflaming to your skin. So depending on what type of skin type, it determines what type of skin treatment that you may move forward in hyperpigmentation. So before we want to move on, we did want to do a shout out for these three people here. Magdalene Mendoza, Alice Leidke, or Alice Leidke, thank you for watching. I think she's all the way from Alaska, or was it Carol? Carol Dozier. So thank you guys all. If you guys are binge watchers, because some of you tell me that you are, let me know in the comments that you are, and we will do a shout out to let you know. Thank you very much for watching and supporting our channel. Hey there, my name is Christy, and I have been treating clients with hyperpigmentation, acne, and other skin conditions for over 11 years. So for those of you who don't know, I actually am a licensed professional and have been treating all types of skin. Now this video is specifically dedicated to those of you in Australia who requested over and over to do a hyperpigmentation series, so this is for you. So in this video, we're going to be talking about the different types of skin types that you may have and how it responds to hyperpigmentation, the internal and external causes of hyperpigmentation, and three is the different types of hyperpigmentation. So for those of you who are not sure what hyperpigmentation is basically where a specific area of the skin, it's usually where the sun is regularly exposed to the skin, so namely the face, it could be the neck, chest, and even the hands, where darker dots to all the way to darker patches of skin is where there's more melanin than the surrounding area. Okay, so the first type of hyperpigmentation is one of the more common ones, and it's called Lentigines, otherwise known as liver spots or age spots. So those are the dark, it actually is a little bit larger than a freckle, and it's actually mainly caused by age. Over 90% of light-skinned individuals over the age of 60 have some form of this, and this is actually, instead of being caused by melanin, it is actually by this thing called lipofuscin or Lipofuscin, and it is pigments that are actually, it can be found on organs such as your liver, your kidney, different organs of the body. It can be found on your face and even on your lip. So if you ever said, oh, I have a freckle on my lip, that's probably what that's caused by. The second one is post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, short is PIH. It's more commonly known as like acne scars or acne spots. It can be caused by anytime you have a rash or a cut or an abrasion, and the reddish brown all the way to dark brown scar, superficial scar that is left behind, that is typically known as post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So if you have a pimple and the pimple heals, that, and it ranges depending on how light or how dark your skin is. So obviously, the darker your skin is, the more likely that the post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation is going to be dark brown. For those of you who have fair skin, it'll probably be a reddish brown to a dark red scar. So that's post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. That is actually the easiest to treat. Then the next one would be probably the age spots. And then the third one is melasma. So melasma, it can be known as cloasma or nicknamed the pregnancy mask. And that is because when women are pregnant, sometimes they form these larger brown patches around their eyes or on their face. It's most commonly found on the forehead, around the eyes or the cheek area, and even on the upper lip. And this is more hormonally driven, and it can be exacerbated even more with UV exposure. So this is not just about driven by like hormones from pregnancy, but it could be from thyroid, if you have thyroid issues and you're on hormone treatments, or menopause or perimenopause. Anything that is driving irregular hormonal fluctuations can affect the melasma or melanin production in your skin, causing irregular pigments to be produced. So obviously the area that is darker is producing more melanin than the surrounding area. So because that is hormonally driven, that one is the most difficult to treat, and it takes the longest to treat. And then the other one is driven usually more by age and can be exacerbated by UV exposure. So the next one I'm going to talk about is not really a type of hyperpigmentation. It's actually a type of dermatitis that can leave hyperpigmentation, and this is called phytophotodermatitis. And basically what that is when the plant chemical rubs upon your skin and then is exposed to sun exposure, it can cause, for some people, it becomes itchy and it can cause blisters. And some people, it doesn't even cause any blisters or not even itchiness, but then it forms, it looks like drips on their skin, or blotchiness of reddish brown. So it could be plants such as citrus fruits, namely lime, celery, carrots, parsnips, parsley. So there's certain types of plant chemicals that when rubbed up against the skin and then you're out in the sun, that is what that is. So this is also known as margarita dermatitis, like the lime, or berloque dermatitis. So this leads now to my next point, which is external causes versus internal causes. So obviously external causes are a lot easier to treat than internal causes. So some external causes are things such as taking medication. So some medications, especially antibiotics, can make your skin more photosensitive. So that can cause hyperpigmentation. If you're using acne medication or you're taking medication for cancer, these are all things that can affect the skin. And there's actually something called DIH, which is drug-induced hyperpigmentation. So obviously the hyperpigmentation is brought about by some kind of prescription medication, or even topical medications, whether it's for acne or you're using Retin-A, that brings on even more hyperpigmentation because it causes more photosensitivity in the skin. So once again, the internal things that can affect hormones. So usually people will attribute it to hormones, which is true. However, things like stress that can also affect your hormones, and even diseases that affect the hyperpigmentation, such as Addison's disease, Cushing disease, and hypothyroidism. One way that you can kind of tell if it's drug-induced hyperpigmentation is it actually has a more of a diffused look. It's usually drug-induced. So the other one is external factors. So obviously sun exposure is one. Another one that a lot of people don't think about is clothing. Because when the clothing is constantly rubbing against your skin, it can cause hyperpigmentation. So some of the more common areas that you can have this is underneath the arms or the underarm area. It could also be in between the thighs and towards the back, where your inner thighs rub against each other when you're wearing jeans or shorts. Another one can be fragrance-induced hyperpigmentation. This is common when women will shave under their arms or wax, or any, you know, when they are taking hair off and they're taking some skin off with it, and they're using an underarm deodorant that has a fragrance. And so what happens over time is then their underarm starts to look dark and brown. So even though they may not have any hair there, from afar it could look like it has some shadowing there, and they can develop hyperpigmentation that way. So here is a tip: if you are shaving or you're waxing, do not use any fragranced deodorant. So 2 days before you do an underarm wax or shave, 2 days after, use something that does not have any fragrance in there, so you don't develop that hyperpigmentation. And the other one too is allergies. So for people who have just incessant seasonal allergies. They can even form hyperpigmentation around the nose area and upper lip because they're constantly rubbing with the tissue. So even there isn't an ingredient. Now this ingredient can be controversial in the skincare circles, and that's a whole nother video. I'm not talking about that. But for those of you who are using hydroquinone, which is basically a skin bleaching ingredient, it is illegal in a lot of countries, but in America it's not. But even extended use of hydroquinone can actually increase hyperpigmentation. So each person's skin is very individual, and how that person's skin responds to treatment, medication, ingredients is completely different. So just because I'm saying this on the video and you're saying, well, that's not me, that is not true, you have to remember that these are things that have been found in clinical studies. I have treated literally tens of thousands of people as far as their skin is concerned. So you have to remember that everyone is a little bit different. And so if you start to see any form of hyperpigmentation, whatever you may think it is, you know, you may want to change course or start to pay attention to see what things may be causing the hyperpigmentation. Also, where you are on the Fitzpatrick scale, and the Fitzpatrick scale, depending on how you answer it, will determine how your skin will respond to hyperpigmentation and UV exposure. So in 1975, he was a doctor and a PhD, Dr. Thomas B. Fitzpatrick, and that's the scale that was named, or he named it, I guess, or it was named after him. Basically, based on how you answered the questions would determine, or better determine, how your skin would respond to UV exposure and hyperpigmentation. So this scale basically showed the different classifications based on how you answered it, and it was everything from, you know, what color your hair was, what color your eyes were, what color your skin was, how your skin responded after it had some sun exposure. So we'll go over it and we'll find out which type are you. However, I will say in 2013 there was a clinical study that was done on how accurate this Fitzpatrick scale was, and it was shown that when it was self-reported, so basically when people did the self-assessment on their own, it was less accurate than when a dermatologist did an assessment on their patient. Links are in the description below that I put in, that you can actually see the Fitzpatrick scale. The one I did in particular, I really liked it because the Australian government actually put it out. And the reason why I liked it is because it actually had actual pictures of people that fell under those categories, so you could better identify with where you are on the Fitzpatrick scale. So we're going to start off with Fitzpatrick skin type number one, and this is someone who has naturally blonde hair or naturally red hair. They have very light blue eyes, very light gray eyes, or very light green eyes. They have ivory skin or porcelain skin before sun exposure. They typically don't tan. They always burn. They always peel, and they have some freckles. So the next one is Fitzpatrick skin type number two. They basically have blonde hair, naturally blonde hair, naturally light, very light brown hair. They have blue eyes, gray eyes, or green eyes. They have fair skin. Freckling is common. So they don't tan very easily, if you could call it a tan. They burn frequently. They peel most of the time. They don't really tan. Freckles are common. So Fitzpatrick skin type number three. So this is someone who has naturally like darker blonde hair or light brown hair. They have white skin, but it has a golden tone. They may have hazel eyes or brown eyes. They don't really tan that well. They may have some freckling. It occasionally tans and occasionally burns. Skin type number four. Okay, so now we're getting a little bit to individuals that can respond better to the sun. So they have darker hair. They have hazel or brown eyes. They have olive skin tone. They tan more than they burn. They sometimes peel if they get a burn. And they don't typically freckle. So Fitzpatrick skin type number five, they have dark brown hair to to very dark brown hair. They have brown skin to very dark brown skin. They have brown eyes or very dark brown eyes. They almost never burn. They tan very easily. They do not freckle. So the last one is Fitzpatrick skin type number 6. So this is someone who has a very dark brown hair to espresso brown, almost black hair. They have very dark brown skin, very dark brown skin. They have brown eyes to very deep dark brown eyes. They never burn. They always tan. They tan very easily. They don't have any freckling. So that is the last one. So these are the 6 Fitzpatrick skin types, and you may fall in between them because, again, they're based on tone, not on any particular race, and I'll put the links below in the description. So this is why it's very important to know where you fall in the Fitzpatrick scale, because once you understand the basic foundation of how your skin responds to hyperpigmentation, the better you're more educated in choosing the right treatment for your skin for the hyperpigmentation, if it's more externally caused versus internally caused, where you are in the Fitzpatrick scale, so you can have a more effective in determining hyperpigmentation, because from there, then you can start looking for treatments that are best for you. So remember, makeup is an art and skincare is a science.